All right, so let's dive into this. So Roxy Music. So tell me about your story with Roxy Music. When did you first hear them and catch us up to today?
Well, I'm 53 years old, and the first
you look great.
I feel great.
Jesus.
The first three or four records with Brian Eno was, to me, layers, like an onion. You can keep listening and finding new things about it. And it's not just the outer layer, and it's not the way you've heard it the first time. It's the way you hear it over and over.
Yeah.
And that's what turned me on at first. And I know Brian split before Siren, but they used Chris Thomas as a producer, I think, prior to Siren. And what Chris was doing with the Pretenders and the Pistols and Paul McCartney, you can hear him capture the noise of a band. And he didn't produce them and change them. He just had them rehearse a lot and work on the tracks over and over to get the tracks right and to grab the essence of the people in the band. That's what I love about Roxy Music. You can hear personalities. And usually that's what gets me into a band. It's the song, it's the lyrics, but it's also hearing who these people are. I never got to meet them, but you get to know them through their music. And, you know, Brian being like this romantic crooner, but always kind of a cynic about love. And the saxophone and the raw drums and a little bit of that Jamaican influence I hear.
Yeah.
Which American bands never were great at grasping that. But when you talk about UK with Madness, and the Specials, and of course the Clash,
Police.
And, you know, the Police. You hear that Jamaican African influence, and they never ignored it. You know, even heard a little bit with the Pretenders' first record.
Yeah.
And I always thought to myself, what did Chris Thomas actually talk to Jane's Addiction in the early days? We were talking about having him get involved with us. We did our own thing, and it came out perfect. But we talked to Roy Thomas Baker and Chris Thomas and some of the UK cats because we loved the music that was coming out of there, and we loved hearing those personalities on those records.
Yeah.
You know, that to me, and of course, when Brian Eno started doing his solo stuff and all of them made a solo record, I think during the Siren time, they were all kind of spreading out. And I think Andy was working on a TV show, the Rock Follies, writing music for that, for the BBC show. So they were all kind of exploring their own personalities by the time they got to Siren. And I think there was a little bit of friction, and that friction does make a great record.
Yeah.
That's really, you know, pre-Siren, there was this experimental, like I say, the onion, the layers I would check out. And when Siren happened, it seemed like there were songs. And songs you not only get the personalities of these musicians, but the lyrics and the sadness of that running, of course, the record cover. And she's there on lava rocks. It just seemed very tasty. I need to listen to this.
Yeah.
And, you know, there was something great about, of course, holding an album and looking at the cover and reading the liner notes and getting to know the band through that way. The songs, the lyrics, the artwork, who recorded it, who produced it, where it was recorded. I think they did a Siren at Air. And I always thought, I want to record it Air. I want to record where the sound sounds. It's layered, but it's right in your face. And as an older musician now, I understand when you play music, you have to think about the mix. Where's the cymbal going to sit? Where's the low end going to sit? How does the vocal sit right in the middle? And who's going to mix it? And who's going to master it? So it was a real experience as a young musician to hear Roxy Music as this UK British rock band with a sense of African and Jamaican, even though they weren't in any way reggae, but they used that understanding of how to place that pulse in a song.
Sure.
And they all had their own, each song was separate from the last one. And, you know, a lot of bands, the whole record sounded the same, but Roxy Music, each song was different. And I love that about British rock and roll music, because Jane's Addiction was great at that too, because Perry would write these poems. They weren't lyrics in my idea. They were poems. They didn't say verse, chorus, bridge, chorus, out. It was a poem. One line was 5 words. One line was 7 words. One line was 2 words. So how do you write music around that? And I would recognize that in Roxy Music, how these, I heard the lyrics actually came later. The songs were written musically, then the lyrics, but I wasn't there. hear these incredible poems and these stories that would pull you in, and these soundscapes. And when Brian Eno did Tiger Mountain and I heard his record, I can still listen to that today and go on a journey. So when Siren happened and Eno wasn't there, and then they had a hit. They had Love is a Drug became a hit. And it's like, this is actually some, it's a single. And I, you know, they came to America. I was too young to go watch it, but they were all kind of separating in solo careers, and Andy was doing his TV movement. But when they came together for that record, it was really a great accomplishment of art, visual art, lyrics, the sadness of that romantic crooning, and the instrumentation, and of course Chris Thomas bringing it together. You hear it on the first Pretenders record. It's a sonic experience, and the songs are great, but it's also the way they're presented. And yeah. I always think a great producer will go to a rehearsal room and listen to them play and say, how do I capture that sound and put it on a record, opposed to getting a producer that says, this is the drum set I use, that's the studio I use, these are the amps I use, and I use it on every record, and the records start to sound the same. Chris Thomas was great at capturing the band. And there was that, it was danceable, there was a pulse to it with Roxy Music, but there was stories behind the lyrics, and that was intriguing to me as a young player.
Yeah.
And it wasn't about fireworks and big events. And I love that with rock and roll drumming. I love looking for those big events. You mentioned the Police. You know, I guess Sting wrote some great songs, but without Stuart Copeland, there's no emergency. There's no urgency.
Yeah,
there's no event, you know, it's a good song. And so with Roxy Music, they had all these great players, but they wouldn't stick out in any sense. They would really become a unit, and there's a lot of unity. And that was it doesn't sound like Supertramp or Pink Floyd, but I always hear that with those bands, that no one stuck out as something special. It was the presentation of the whole sound.
Yeah.
You know?
I got to go back for one thing, because two things. One, when you called yourself an older musician, you realize that like Keith Richards is 140 years old, dude, and he's still doing it. You are not old yet, bro. So that's get true. That, throw that in the trash. Secondly, like, so this is my second Roxy Music record. Morty, what was the first one we did?
We did, For Your Pleasure.
For Your Pleasure.
That's the last Eno record.
And then we've done two Brian Eno solo records. I wonder, and Morty, I don't know if you have this in the intro, but I wonder if they still use the obligatory cards. Is that what they're called?
League strategies weren't invented yet. Eno didn't work with them yet. He invented them in his production.
Oh, yeah. Because, you know, but that's such an interesting way to write. For me, I was actually shocked when I found out that Brian Eno wasn't on this record, because it still sounds like they, you know, left his influence on Roxy. But, and I don't know if you agree with me, Stephen, is that this is probably out of For Your Pleasure, this is like a way more, like, this is almost like a pop record to an extent. It's danceable, it's upbeat. Dude, like, this is the truth. Before we dive into the intro, dude, I was listening to another record. I was listening to Arctic Monkeys to get ready for another podcast. And I had like five albums on one playlist that I had saved on Spotify so I could, you know, save it to the phone. And with the one record, the Arctic Monkeys record ended, and it switched over. And I thought it just went to some random British band that maybe was out the same time as the Arctic Monkeys. And Love is a Drug came on, and I was like, who the fuck is this? This shit slaps. And then I found out it was Roxy, and I couldn't have been more excited to dive into this record, because
that's cool.
Dude, to be surprised
by music and the sonics and what it does to you.
Yes.
And you know, it's such a sad case when there is no artwork to hold and the music comes out of your phone. I love having a nice speaker system and a piece of art to look at and lyrics to read and take that experience. Maybe you don't listen to the 38 minutes or the 45 minutes and it's a song at a time, but I love the record when it's presented even side by side. You know, side A is an experience separate than side B. And when CDs happened, it would just flow all the way through. And then when streaming happened, it was a song at a time and you lose that experience. But Roxy Music would present this experience. And Love is a Drug, the first song on the record, And there's like almost sound effects. Like you feel like you're in their world. You're brought into their world, into a dance floor, into a club, into a black taxi, those big English taxis they have. And you fucking taste it. You feel
it. Oh, governor, where am I taking you to? By the way, do you want to buy some Charlie? Because I'm dealing that on the side.
There you go. Hello, governor.
Hello, governor. Want to hear some of that Brian Ferry music? All right. I got some Roxy music for you right now. Have some wine gums. The chocolate here. Delicious.
I find that, you know, with Ferry's voice, it's like how many crooners are in rock and roll? There's not too many. Not many. He's one of the great men. He wraps you up. And it's like a nice breeze. You can be 100 pounds overweight or you can be anorexic, but the breeze caresses the size of your body.
Ooh, I love that.
It doesn't matter what size you are, how tall or short, the breeze will accompany you. And I feel that with their music, and it's an emotional experience, and it's a magnet, and people are drawn to this emotion. Why does a song break barriers? And why does a song that's big in the UK get big in Canada and also in America, and then you go to Mexico and you hear it there, and it's, why does that happen? It's the way it feels.
Yeah.
And you know, as a drummer, people always talk about what's the most important, chops, you know, the fireworks. It's the feel. And when you get a chance to play a reggae band, the drummer from Steel Pulse passed away, so about 2 years ago the Pulse came to LA and we had 10 different drummers play 10 different songs. And you really got to hear everyone's feel. And everybody, no one felt like the guy from Steel Pulse who just passed away, but everyone had their own feel. But none of us were from the UK or Jamaica. We're all LA drummers. And it didn't feel right, but it felt different.
Yeah.
It was a real challenge for me to like take a breath. And I stepped into the song Taxi Driver. And at the very end, it pulses up like a good old rock and roll tune. But most of the first 3 or 4 minutes is way back there. And I would think about the bass player. He'd be on 1-2. I would still think 1. I wanted to be behind the beat. So if he was on 3, I was still thinking 2. You know, I just barely right behind him. And I think if you think about Bonham, you know, Zeppelin always had energy, but the drums were just a little bit farther back. And so if you count 1, 2, 3, 4, there's a lot of space between those words. 1. So do you think about 1 with the letter O, or do you think about 1 with the letter E? And I think about Bonham. He thought of 1, and he always thought of 1. And then the E, he thought of the very edge of 1. And if with 2, the very edge of 2. And he would think of these words and they'd be big and long. 1, 2. I could be crazy. I might be crazy. But, you know, you could chop it up like a Satoshi of a Bitcoin. There's a million of them in one coin. You could chop it up, you know.
Yeah.
So you could chop up these beats and really figure out the feel. And Roxy music feels good.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, that's a whole other issue of like what the song's about, what the production is. Is it a saxophone? Is it a keyboard? Is it a voice? But it felt good. And I think that's what really made me aware of the power of Roxy music. And then to like get in there and then discover the personalities, like I was saying earlier, that's exciting to get to know the musicians, though I never met them. You get to know them because of the way they play.
Yeah, you know
them. I never met Keith Moon, but you know he's a maniac because of the way he plays drums. You know?
You can taste the scotch in the music. It's like you can taste it. It's so good.
When I close my eyes and I hear Keith Moon, I think of a guy playing timpani drums and two cymbals in his hand, like an orchestra.
Yeah.
Boom, 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 boom. Big event. I don't think of a drum set, and I see him playing a drum set, but I hear an orchestral drummer. And when I think about Roxy music, I do think about this ensemble, guys that listen to each other and that are presenting a picture for the listener, this visual cinematic picture that tells a story. And Brian was never, in a sense, in your face, but the mix, his voice was always right in your face, but his attack was never. He was laid back. And that's such a great little, you know, charm for a band to have.
Very charming. Yes. I got to give a shout out right now. Morty and JT know him, but there's a drummer in my band, Nick Liberatore. We always talked about, cause I'm friends with Bill Burr and he's a drummer when he did the show, and, you know, his chops aren't as good as, like, you know, as Nick's, cause Nick's a professional drummer. That's what he does. But we were talking about it after the first time we jammed with Burr, and Nick goes, he's like, dude, he's got the feel and that's all that matters. And I was like, there it is. And that's in everything, dude. You could be a comic, you can be an actor. If you can feel it, you might not be technical. Like, I don't know, like Brando, you're probably technical, but what he had was the feel. He felt it.
My search of rhythm goes deep into the comedian and the actor, the timing that it takes to tell a joke right and to feel it when it should pull and not. And the drummer's got the same job. And there's a rhythm in everything. The guy that rolls the cigars in Cuba, and the guy that sets the lights in Bali for the traffic, you know, he's messing with people because he just wants to have a good time.
Yeah.
But there's rhythm to all that. And I played a party with Bill, and Bill played Highway to Hell.
Oh, that was where Slash and Duff and the guy from Apocalypta, I can't think of his name, that really great singer, I have a video clip of him telling that story, and it's one of the funniest things, because he had no idea that he was going to be jamming with Duff and Slash.
That's great.
Kushner set him up, and then they walked out, and he was like, I'm sitting behind the drum set, and it was like two trees came to life. Like, I couldn't, like, I was just, the way I looked to the audience must have been in complete and utter shock and awe. But
well, you know,
I love that you were there, dude. I fucking love that you were there.
I love the fact that the drummer never, I mean, yeah, we use mallets and we use brushes, but we don't paint. We're like a hammer and a nail. Yeah. You walk into a silent room and you puncture the sound as a drummer. You have to be confident to puncture the sound, or there's no punch. And it's like putting a nail in a wall to hang a picture. You know when it goes in right, that one stroke, and you don't have to, you know, hit it again, or the nail goes in sideways, or you hang the picture and it's too high, too low. You got to pull it out and leave a hole. Yeah. You know, no, that's not drumming. Drumming is knowing where the hole is or where the height is, hitting it and goes in right. Yeah. And Bill's got that. And the great drummers, I think, usually have this confidence to break silence with piercing the silence with a drumstick and a cymbal or a bass drum or snare drum. And, you know, growing up, I started on pillows and I had to learn how to bounce off a pillow, and it was a quiet experience. Then I got a snare drum. I had to learn how to bounce off a tight head, and it was a loud experience. And then I got a drum set. I had to learn how to use my hips and my ankles and figure out the difference between the bass drum tone and the cymbal and the snare. And those all had different surfaces. And then you have to listen to other musicians and take all that and put it away and listen to what the guys are doing. And then the lyrics, what is he singing about? And then when does he throw the words in? The words are almost like a percussion player. He's you know, phrasing that, and you have to listen to that. So the drummer's got this great responsibility to learn about the volume and the dynamics, how to punch the sound and brush it, and then through all that, listen so you don't step on anybody.
For sure. Dude, it's incredible. All right, I forgot we have a podcast to do. I could have just talked to you about just this from the jump. All right, Morty, you want to catch us up to this record, dude?
Absolutely. And by the way, Perry did another Green World on here. And so
Did. Perry did Brian Eno, another Green World.
And we had Ward on here also. So yeah, we're getting all you guys. This is your life, Stephen Perkins. All right.
I recognize Rabbi Zeldin.
He is. There he comes. Stephen S. Weiss, shout out. Right off the 405. So released on October 24th, 1975 on Island and Atco Records, produced by Chris Thomas. This is the fourth album by the British glam rock art pop rock band. Okay, I'm going to break this down. We've already done one of their albums. We did it with John Taylor for Your Pleasure. So great. He's already, so we already, if you guys want to listen to that episode, you'll catch all the earlier part of it. So we already know Eno is already out of the band. This is the second record without him. He's basically replaced by Eddie Jobson, who also played electric fiddle or electric violin and was more of a contemporary, more of a traditional keyboard player.
You can call it a fiddle. Fiddle and violin are the same thing. People knew what you were talking about. People knew.
Yeah, Gibby Haynes said that once and offended Lily Hayden. All right. So it left Brian so he could be the front man. So Eddie took over keyboards. Prior to that, Brian Ferry was also playing keyboards and singing. So on this album, the last album, Country Life, had Andy McKay, who's the multi-instrumentalist and the guitarist Phil Manzanera, join Ferry as co-songwriters. The band's rounded out on the record by drummer Paul Thompson, fucking amazing, and bassist John Gustafson, who was, although he was in the band, technically not in the band, he was just on the albums. And okay. For this album, Jobson actually got a songwriting credit for this one as well. They all realized they could make money on it by this point, and so Brian wasn't the only one. Only 7 months after the release of their third album, Country Life, they recorded this in London during the summer of 75 with Chris Thomas, who had done all three previous albums. It would be their fourth in 2.5 years. And
wow.
Early records. Yeah. They're
churning them out, dude. Ferry wants that dough.
And Ferry was doing solo stuff in between cover records. So he didn't stop. So while those were much more experimental, they had more challenging and stuff. This is actually way more accessible and commercial than anything they'd done up until that point. Subject matter was still basically between heartbreak and getting hooked back into heartbreak and all of that. And Ferry's lingering preoccupation with faded. You'll be able to read that later. It appeared right as the phenomenon of disco music was luring people to discotheques, single bars and inevitable love hangovers and, you know, capturing the spirit of that moment. So the band continued to be aware of Brian's aspirational ascendancy to fame and fortune with or without them. So although this record was a smash in the UK, it brought them their biggest success in America, which also gave them the first headlining tour. They ended up taking a 4-year break right after this so they could pursue solo projects. They essentially broke up. So Brian's career kind of fizzled and the band came back more refined and, you know, critically and commercially acclaimed, although each record they would dwindle down one member until it was essentially like down to like two or three of them.
Until it's just Ferry.
It's just coming through. And although they got back, they were inactive for like 20 years. They got back together intermittently in 2001 for some tours. And in 2005, they attempted a reunion album that became a 2010 Brian solo project. And in 2019, we're inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame by Duran Duran, Simon Le Bon, and our past guest, John Taylor.
Oh, little JT. Man, is he? Have you ever seen him in person, Stephen? Because that dude is
That's
dreamy.
A good looking fella.
That is, I couldn't even talk. I was like, I've never had these thoughts before. The dance into the fire. It's a beautiful.
I was talking to my 11-year-old and explaining to him what MTV did and didn't do for music. And I said, if you were easy on the eyes, you got pretty big pretty quick. And
yes, you did.
It really didn't matter. And I could sit on a plane with the guys in Pink Floyd or Supertramp and not even know who I'm sitting next to because they never took pictures, you know?
Yeah, dude. Duran Duran could fart into the microphone and it would have been a top 10 hit, dude. They were made for MTV.
And then you had, you know, some of the problems with MTV is someone like Winger, you know? And
oh, yeah, dude.
You know, he easy on the eyes and he did ballet, but there was nothing to... There's no onion there. There's no layer.
I just want to stop right here. We've been doing this podcast for over 2.5 years, and this is our first Winger reference. And I mean, this just deserves a huge round of applause. I mean, She's Only 17 is literally pedophilia.
It's true. I mean, you know what's crazy? He had the Dixie Dregs drummer, Rod Morgenstein, one of these great drummers, progressive rock drummers. But, you know, when you want to get paid, you know, join Winger. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that.
And one of us.
But
it's true, because if you think about the presentation that Roxy did on stage and even Brian as a solo tour, there was a sense that you were coming into a an experience, and you're going to go away for 2 hours and get away from your life and enjoy this romantic, cynical in a sense, broken heart romance. But it was a journey. And like you said, there was the 70s and disco was starting to really knock the doors down. But this record is danceable, even though, you know, prior with Eno, there was a little more experimenting. The tones were there. It still was an experimental record for British rock music.
Yeah.
And they did tour America and do some, I think it was a theater tour, which is perfectly set and suited for them. And when James did a theater tour, we showed up for soundcheck and we were loving it. What a beautiful theater. But halfway through the show, we're like, there's all seats. There's no GA. This is killing me, man. Let's pull the seats out and have a party, because that theater will keep people in their seats. But Roxy Music, perfectly suited for a theater tour. Absolutely.
Oh, you could do this album at an opera.
Yeah.
This is Royal Albert Hall type shit. Like this is, you know, Kennedy Center. I think that is what's so interesting about Roxy Music, from what I know, is it's art. It's like when music, everything's art, but this is art. This is art. This is for real. This is a painting. You might not get it right away, but after a couple listens, you're like, oh wow, I see it. I feel it. You know,
absolutely.
But this one in particular, because the other record that we did, I can't, For Your Pleasure. That one, yeah. It didn't hit me right away. This one, the first time I heard it, I was like, dude, I mean, it opens with Love is the Drug. So let's dive into that. All right. So Love is the Drug, it opens a record. It's the first single, was originally a slow Andy McKay instrumental, and it went to number 2 in the UK and became their only top 40 hit in America, reaching number 30. I already told you this could have come out now. That's how good this song is, that it just transcends 70s, 80s, 90s, 60s. It's just current. It's so good. I found this online comparing romantic longings with those of drug users is a classic trope in popular music, going back to Love Jones and You're Getting to Be a Habit with Me. This is what the part that I found was interesting. Considering that love actually does cause the production of mind altering chemicals, this is perhaps unsurprising. It makes perfect sense, because we do stupid shit when we're in love.
Well,
right?
this is great. One more point on that. Sweet. Love is like oxygen. Come on. Now that's
good.
That is right there. But you know, I was talking to my son, and he believes only in science. He doesn't believe there's a God. He's 11. And I said, look, you love mom and dad, but you can't scientifically prove love. Not everything is proved with science, man. And not that I'm saying I believe or don't believe in God, but don't make your choice yet, because when you fall in love, it's different than loving mom and dad. You'll feel this love, this pain, and this pleasure, and this pull. But there's no science to it. But you're right. It does chemically change you.
Changes. I've done stupid shit. I remember one time I called this girl. This is back before cell phones. I called this girl's house 50 times in a row because I was like, nobody was home, and I didn't have an answering machine. And I mean, if she would have seen that, well, she probably did see it, because we never hung out again. I mean... Yeah. Maybe they did have a caller ID. Jeez.
Well, I've got a romance with my drumsticks in my hands. And now this last 12 months of this COVID hell, I've reintroduced this love affair of sitting behind a drum set and just practicing rudiments. It's almost like a basketball player who's a pro, but just does free throws and never has a game.
Yeah.
You practice the hand-eye coordination, and there's a romance to figuring out how the ball goes perfectly in as a swish. But at the same time, the game is when that urgency and that the competitive stuff comes out. And that's when it all comes into play. That's being on stage. But there is this romance you have. If you can find an art that you love, or a sport, or a girl, and it's so important to get it right. And you know, that's and it's a great accomplishment to put that into a lyric and put it into a song, and for the song to live on. And I've got a band with Gilby Clark called Halloween Jack. We actually do cover Love is a Drug.
Nice.
We put a little more muscle into it, and we sped it up a little, because, you know, we don't want to replicate the great one. And if you don't make it different, what's the point? But the lyrics really catch fire when you're in a band that plays it, and you have to listen to it and play to it, not just enjoy it as a listener, but be a actually a component. to making the song great.
Yeah, I love that.
I remember hearing Ringo Starr say, it's not just about the song. What are the lyrics? And that's why, as a kid, he said, you play for the song. And as a kid, I didn't know what that meant. But if you read the lyrics, it makes perfect sense. You play for the song. You play for what the point is. What's the subject matter? What's the theory? What's the philosophy of this tune? Why are we playing it? And Love is the Drug is a perfect example, man.
Yeah, dude. I want to talk about drugs, though. So there's really no way to talk about some of your previous projects without kind of bringing that subject up. But you never really seemed to be about that world. So what I want to know is, how did you avoid it? Or did you just survive it on the down low?
Well, I really was good at avoiding some of the alleys that my friends and band members went down. Okay. Sure. But I was always obsessed with this stamina, athletic endurance contest I had with myself. I wanted every show to be great as a drummer, as an athlete. And I always thought, if I can think it, but my hands and feet can't play it, and what's the point of thinking it? So there was this chase I had with myself to get better every night and never overdo it, never step on the song, but try new ideas and never be dull or numb to this creative experience. And I grew up in a family that stayed together. My parents were together for 50 years. I wasn't escaping any pain. I was a drummer in Jane's Addiction at 17, and it all was just a perfect dream come true.
Yeah.
So it was, and it was hard to see my friends and family and band members go down those alleys and see not only the pleasure, but the pain of it. And to see the, in a sense, there's no tunnel you can get out of it. You have to like dig and dig and dig. There's really no way out until you make the choice. Enough is enough. And so I never really wanted to go there, but I enjoyed watching my friends get really high. And then I got really sad when I saw them coming out of it, you know, and I was there for them. Never judgment. If someone gets overweight, you don't judge them. You help them stop eating. If someone gets stuck out, no judgment. Just try to help them get off it, you know? And the real bummer is the amount of work you could do if you're not fucked up. But, you know, that's the way things rolled, man. And it's true. Porno for Pyros and Jane's Addiction and a lot of other bands I work with, it's tempting to get high and hang out all day because you don't have a day job. Your job's 9 to 5, 9 p.m. to 5 a.m. It's a different 9 to 5, you know, and people offer you these great substances to kind of alter you. But it is about changing your perception when you create, but not escaping it. And I never needed to escape anything, but I did like to get into a room and turn the lights out, light some candles, and just kind of get the tip of the iceberg of those things and see where the creative flow goes, but never wanted to interfere with my performance and that communication between my thought and how the music should sound. And if my hands and feet, could they pull it off? That was so important to me.
Oh, I'm the same way. For years I used to smoke pot and then go on stage, and sometimes it was the greatest thing ever. And I was super funny and I was on point and hilarious. And then other times I self-sabotaged. And you know, like you said, it's like, dude, we get high off of playing. You know, I know when you're in a full room, or you're not even a full room, when you're just jamming with your homies in the studio, there's a connection, an energy that you get in music and in comedy. When I'm talking with the audience, that is a drug. So why would I want to put something on top of that to not feel that? Now, that being said, I did do really well when I used to take Oxycontin and go on stage. So, I mean, it's 6 and 12 is half a dozen, you know. Morty, is there anything you want to add about the song, bud?
Yeah, according to Nile Rodgers, John Gustafson's bass line for this inspired Bernie Edwards' bass line for Chic's Good Times, which we know was recreated in 79 for Rapper's Delight for the Sugar Hill Gang. So you could say in some small way, Roxy Music may have contributed to the birth of hip hop.
Nah, they didn't. But I like that. I like trying to add it.
It's like, going with it.
Let's let the black people have it, dude. Let them have something, finally.
Like you said, I love tracing the roots of people and their music. And what did Stuart Copeland listen to? Why does he play drums that way? What did, you know, how did Jamaican music happen? A combination of the Caribbean and African. But why is reggae is so different than anything else we've ever heard. Why is it that way? What are the roots? Where did they come from? And as a young drummer, it was about jazz drummers, because I love the personalities and the conversation that drummers had with the other instruments with jazz. And then Motown happened and the instruments didn't need the conversation. They needed a clock. And the drummer became this anchor, and it was separate of jazz. There was no conversing. It was just lay the pocket. And then rock and roll happened, and that's the conversation meets the clock. And you can hear Ringo and Charlie Watts and Ginger Baker and Mitch Mitchell tipping their hat to swing and jazz, but they're conversing with the instruments that are around them, like John Coltrane and Elvin Jones having this incredible musical argument almost. And you can hear that with Mitch Mitchell and Jimi Hendrix. They're talking and they're shouting and they're listening and they're bending and morphing. And so there's this great chase of where the roots are, where does it come from, why did it happen, and does it matter when you're enjoying the music? No, but it's a fascinating story, what that bass line turned into and who it inspired and what that poem did to another musician. And then you hear about I think, you know, it's a blues riff. Did it come from the early 1900s, or did it come from, you know, the 40s and 50s of Chicago? We don't know, but there's something that it feels like the blues. Yeah.
No, I get it. Totally.
And so I love hearing that the roots changed and the bass line inspired other music.
I can see that. Yeah, yeah. I could see how this inspired that bass line, because it's very, very similar. All right, end of the line.
So, James, me and Navarro were loving Metallica and Iron Maiden when we were 17. Perry and Eric were about Joy Division and Bauhaus and Echo and Susie. That's the sound of Jane's Addiction, is a bunch of people that had different record collections. And, you know, I love the songwriting and the presentation of Susie and the Banshees, but I also love the chops of Iron Maiden and the fireworks of those parts. And, you know, I couldn't ignore any of it. And as a musician, I started listening to music that wasn't rock and roll, African music, Baba Tunde Ella Tunji, Indian tabla, Zakir Hussain, and listen to these rhythms that have nothing to do with rock and roll, and then implant them into rock and roll. So when I heard a riff, okay, what would Phil Rudd from AC/DC play? Or what would Baba Tunji Ella Tunji play?
Baba Tunji, Baba Tunji. Yeah. I love saying that.
That's what I would start to play, like Mound Song, Ain't No Right. Some of the tribal stuff in 3 days was inspired by African drummers. And then some of the straighter stuff inspired by, you know, what Phil Rudd, what AC/DC, the meat and potatoes of just no nonsense power.
Yeah. You know? Dig it, dude. I love that. I just love that you're fucking with Metallica and Iron Maiden. How great would that have been if Perry would have gone on stage with flamethrower arms like Bruce Dickinson? I just saw him, dude. I was like, this motherfucker, they got a plane above him. He's like, run to the craziest show I've ever seen. I've never felt safer with the audience, but yeah. Who knows? We could have. Could have been a fucking bomb in the show. All right. End of the line. So Brian takes his heartbreak for a walk in the rain. This features some very lovely violin from Eddie Jobson. Best part is the outro. I want to play it because, dude, this band is, I honestly think we need to call Roxy Music the king of outros. Hold on. Let me get it.
I got it queued up here. Is it this one?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I can barely hear it though. There are just kill it. There are so many great moments on this record, but this one just does it for me. I don't know, Morty, maybe you can correct me, but I feel like they're writing in a very like modal structure. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's almost like they're writing it in parts and then blending it together. Kind of like Smile Sessions.
Yeah. Well, that's why, cause the band, like as Stephen was saying, the band usually worked on the music and then Brian would leave and he would write the lyrics based on what he felt from the music. And then when he came back, he would basically, the band would hear what the hell the songs were after they'd been working on them. So they were just assuming this must be how it goes. Then they would hear the lyric, the melody that he finally put over it. So they wouldn't even know really necessarily what the song was, what it was called, what it was about, or even what it sounded like till they heard, you know, him go to the microphone and they were like, oh, you know, like, oh, okay, that's the song we've been working on for the last week.
And I also heard that he would take his time where they would think, we're done, but no lyrics.
Yeah.
Okay, he's got some of the lyrics, but not the complete melody. And you don't rush those things. It's supposed to come out in September. Well, it comes out in October, guys, because we're not done yet.
I love that.
And that, you know, you don't rush it because once you're done, you can put it to bed. But if you rush it, then you can never listen to it with love. You always think, I could have, I should have, you know, and that's a terrible feeling when you don't get to take your time. But also some of those great songs were written in 1 hour and they last for 100 years. But some songs take a little more caressing.
Yeah.
And you hear about the Beatles, they cut Strawberry Fields 26 times. And as a young man, I thought, that's why. But now I get it. Different tempos, different moments, different arrangements, different outro. And that those outros, James would always pay close attention to the bridge. We got a verse, we got a chorus, we got a solo. Where is the bridge going to take you? And literally, it's going to take you from one place to another. It's a bridge.
Yeah.
And we would pay close attention to our bridges. And you're right. Those outros, they set a whole nother theme, and it's cinematic, and it puts you in a place where you don't want it to end. Just take me there,
dude. So after doing a little bit of research, I think there's a lot of parallels between Roxy and Jane in that right as they were breaking through with a lot of mainstream success, both bands, Jane's included, took a long hiatus. So it's like after the first Lollapalooza tour, which Perry founded, and Jane's Addiction headlined, you guys broke up. And, you know, although you kind of carried on doing the stuff with Infectious Grooves, and you did a side project with Mike from Suicidal Tendencies, and then a couple years later with Perry and Porno for Pyros, Jane's music and Legend basically helped create the alternative scene. So, like, to a degree, I think grunge started when your ripples hit the Pacific Northwest.
Absolutely. So I always think of Jane's Addiction as the soil that the beautiful flowers of the Pumpkins and Tool and Rage and Alice and Soundgarden, they grew out of that soil. And when you look at a flower, you don't think about the soil. You smell it and look at the beauty of it. But it had to come out of fertile soil.
Yeah.
We are fertilizing. Jane's Addiction is the fertilizer for great music. And I definitely love that we did plant we churned up the soil. And in the 80s, there was a lot of great rock and roll, but a lot of it was like this cookie cutter replica stuff. And Jane's was this great hybrid of a bunch of different bands. In a sense, you could have a Cure poster and a Metallica poster that would be a Jane's Addiction fan. And there really was the black lipstick, but also a denim and leather vest. And that was okay. That was what Jane's kind of brought together. But you're right. With Roxy, they're, you know, if you break up because you've had it with each other, or you put enough time into it and you want to try new things. I was very lucky because the day Jane's broke up in Hawaii, Mike from Suicidal with Rob Trujillo, who's the bass player for Metallica now, they were at the show. I got off stage, we broke up, and they said, Infectious Grooves just got a tour with Ozzy, the No More Tears tour. So within 10 minutes, I was in a new band. So I was heartbroken, but then again, I was out on tour with Zach Wilde and Mike Hennett, Dallas, and the great drummer, Randy Castillo, who's passed on. Ozzy had a great band, the No More Tears band.
Yeah.
And I was surrounded not only by new musicians, but a new audience, which was a metal audience, which was completely different than the Jane's Lollapalooza tour with Butthole Surfers and Henry Rollins and Body Count and Susie and Nine Inch Nails. I was on tour with Ozzy, and it was a full metal tour and great musicians and great music fans. But I was saved by those guys. My heartbreak was healed pretty quickly by joining a band that afternoon, right after the show ended. I was in a band. Okay. And then Harry, we talked about Porno. we were going to get to it, but Perry needed a year or two off, and I didn't. I needed to keep playing. I'm that athletic drummer that needs to play. Who knows what it would happen if I had nothing to go to right after we broke up. But
sure, dude.
Yeah,
sure.
But that. Thank you for comparing Jane's to what Roxy did, and to reminding me of what Jane's did for the scene. And it's true. You throw a little pebble in a lake, the ripples might not be huge, but they go all the way to the edge.
Ripples, yeah.
You know, or if you add a tiny drip of blue ink to a glass of water, it goes blue. It might not be a royal blue, but at the tint, we tinted the glass of water.
Oh, 100%, yeah. You tinted it. Yeah. All right. Anything you want to add, Morty?
Yeah, quickly. Concrete Blonde did a cover of this in '93, and their drummer at the time happened to be Roxy Music's Paul Thompson.
Oh, little Paul Thompson. Yeah. Little Polly Thompson.
Interesting. All right.
Sentimental Fool. So this sounds like a Roxy Music song. JT, play 228 if you can. You got it? I got it. All right, kill it. That's got such a Eno, like, I don't know, just the essence of Eno is in that moment. That's the fucking Roxy Music that I heard on For Your Pleasure. But that's what's so great about this album is that they can do that and still have all this like pop shit, because then it comes in, it kicks in a few moments after this, and then it's right back to that new sound off that pop record I'm talking about.
Yeah. And so, what a vocal performance. It's a bird. It's a bird singing. And it's great. And there's courage, and there's a lot of guts and bravery, but never sticking it down your throat, but just gently laying it on the line for the listener.
Oh,
and
totally.
That's hard to do, man. It's now you gotta have big balls to be a sensitive person. You know?
Sure.
You really do. You got to put it out there, and you can't be afraid of what people think or say. It's a feeling that he presented, and the band completely, it's so odd that the lyrics came later, but the band seems like they're completely union when the song was written. Jane's Addiction, my favorite moment is a song called Then She Did. It sounds like the song and the lyric and the production was all born at the same time. It wasn't put together. It came out as is. And it didn't. We worked on it. But when you listen to it, it just sounds like it was just born. And that's what you hear with the song.
Completely. I love that you said it's like, it's almost like heartbreaking. It's just like, you can hear the pain that he's singing about in this song. And then you got Phil's long guitar feedback intro. You got Andy's gorgeous sax solo. And then it's this dramatic ending that is completely epic. It's a really great song, and it's definitely, I think you're finding them like really in the zone. Morty, you want to add anything?
They would open in 75 for this tour. They would open with this. So imagine them putting them right up in front, like you were saying. He comes out, they start this long ass intro, and he walks out in full falsetto and opens the show. I mean, that's putting your balls on the line. That's not coming out like rock and roll. That's like coming out like,
you know, it's theater.
Credit.
It is theater.
Yeah. High camp theater.
High camp. It's Rocky Horror Picture Show, except without throwing toast and rice and shit like that. All right. I just want to mention Whirlwind because Peter, because this is such a great song, and a lot of their fans felt like they were becoming less esoteric and arty. And I could see that from this song. Play the clip, JT. All right, kill it. All right, so this is pop rock. This is not some strange kimono music that they were used to hearing. You know what I mean? This is the anti-kimono music. What do you think?
And, well, I remember hearing that and going, what band is this?
Yeah.
It definitely, you know, and then when you hear it and you find out who it is, it makes sense. But it was one of those songs where it doesn't sound like what you would expect coming from them. And maybe, like you said, the fans were, you know, either on the left or the right of that. Like, I don't know if they dug it or not, but then they start to realize Roxy Music is Roxy Music. It's not a certain song or a certain production or a certain record. And that song is, you know, especially I can hear it in a club or a discotheque back in the day with a good sound system. Like I was saying earlier, it just wraps you up. And I was kind of a shy guy. It was hard for me to ask a strange girl to dance, and not an odd girl, but a stranger.
Yeah.
It was hard. But,
that comes later.
That's the kind of song that I could feel comfortable saying, hey, you want to dance?
Yeah, but didn't they know? But dude, first of all, you're at 17, you're in Jane's Addiction. Like, I mean, it's pretty easy to hit on a girl when you're in some badass fucking, you know, Cali band. I mean, come on, dude. Come on.
Well, I realized with the band and even watching a band, if it's all boys, all girls, it doesn't matter. You see this great talent and them putting them the emotions on the stage. And, you know, MC5 and Iggy, I would think, man, those guys just leave it for us. And Alice Cooper, all the Detroit stuff, they would leave it for the audience and probably limp back to their hotel room and collapse because they give you everything. And with a band like Roxy Music, it's not like the MC5 or Iggy where they're pounding it, but the same thing, they give it to you complete. And it's completely, their heart is on their line, their emotions are on their sleeve, they wear it. And they say, take it or leave it, this is who we are. And that's remarkable, in a sense, an achievement for any band to be completely honest and never back away and never fraudulent, never faking it, you know, never a fake. We're always completely real and layers. Like I said earlier, the onion, you keep on peeling the onion. It looks like an onion, but it gets spicier as you go in.
Yeah.
You know,
I'm sorry. Go on.
No, I was going to say, like, you know, you guys had to leave it out on the stage, man. I mean, just from like the song Stop, like you guys fucking rip that shit. Speaking of which, I was doing shows in Minnesota and they asked for some walk-on music. I was like, yeah, play Stop. And I didn't tell them to get to the gank, 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 gank. So they're like, give it up for Josh Adam Myers. And it's like, Kame sanes miornes. But it's kermo. Then by that, once it got to the gank, I had already walked to the stage and grabbed the mic.
Exactly.
Fucking nuts.
You know what,
dude?
I love about Perry's lyrics? Stop is so relevant. It's about the environment. No one's leaving. It's about racism. You know, ain't no right is about S&M. And I love it because his lyrics are timeless and they're poems. And Stop doesn't have a chorus. It's got two verses, a guitar solo, a long bridge and halftime, and then a vocal break. Sing along with the TV. There's no chorus. It's just
you're right. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah, it's a poem. The song that needed... the lyrics needed a song and the song needed the lyrics, and it's a poem about the environment and being good to Mother Nature. That's how I interpret it.
Well, you know? Perry cares, dude. Perry, listen, when we were at his house, you know, it's before the election. Perry felt, he feels the pain of the world. That's the only way to put it. He cares. And so that makes me feel good to know that Stop is about that, because I just thought it fucking just ripped. You know what I mean? You don't like, I don't care what he's telling me to stop, but I'll stop, but I'm not going to stop listening to this shit. It's badass.
Well, you know, and then the Ted just admitted, nothing shocking, and the images of what you get on TV back then in the late 80s. But think about it now, what all of us have in our hand, this computer, this encyclopedia, this social platform where everyone's got their own TV show. And, you know, you remember the video called Faces of Death?
Oh yeah, dude.
It was like taboo if you got it. Now everyone's got Faces of Death on their phone. I mean,
yeah, dude.
And that was hard to find. And it was like, get together and watch it with your buddies and then freak out for a week. Now it's just there everywhere. And my 11-year-old, you know, can grab a phone and look up something in French that he's trying to transcribe because he's in a French school. And all of a sudden some kind of alert comes on about some horrible event. And where people are being massacred, I'm like, wait, give me the phone. They shouldn't be feeding this to everybody.
No, but, 100%.
It's here. We can't get away. And, politics aside, the friction and the static we've had it's just gnarly, man. And it's been really hard for anybody, especially young people. And I know they're going to come out of it stronger, smarter, and they're going to be able to be more technical, because all the stuff that was here pre-COVID with the Zoom and the Google Meet, et cetera, now it's a necessity. Back then, it was a few people using it. Now everyone's got to understand how to use it, which we ran into some problems this morning, this afternoon, but we got through.
We got through it. But this is the other thing, too. This is the other thing, too, about something as beautiful as COVID is, beautiful, as hard as COVID is, some beautiful things came out of it, knowing that we could get this, we could do this conversation from our homes, and it still sounds like we're in the same room together, and that some people never have to go back to an office again. That's obsolete. You can work from home. So some good things did come of this. Now, I don't really want to talk a lot about She Sells, but you mentioned Faces of Death. The clip I want to play from Seashells almost sounds like the music from Faces of Death. JT, play 2 minutes in, dude.
That poor monkey.
Wait, hold on. Yeah, here it is. Here it is. This is it. Do you remember that? Like, as like people are dying, somebody's jumping off the building and they're playing like, you know, porno music from my dad's collection. Like, it's like, are these people, these Buddhist monks setting themselves on fire to the soundtrack to Debbie Does Dallas?
Yeah, like, it's so cool, man.
Great song.
Yeah, you can do the pogo dance to that.
Oh, for sure, dude. This might, She Sells might be one of my favorite songs on the record. Once again, they kill it with their outro. Do you have that, JT? Play the outro. Come on. Hold on, I got it. I got it.
And it's Eddie's only co-write on this record.
Oh, wow.
That's what I'm talking about like this modal sections, is because that sounds completely different than that place, that part that we just played. And it rips. It's so bomb. It's not even funny. It's phenomenal. That they are the king of outros. If Bruce Springsteen, which I have dubbed the king of the bridge, Roxy Music is the king of the outro. I'm saying it here, Fleece Army.
And you know what? You're bringing up Rocky Horror. There is that sense of glam and theater, but never for the wrong reason, just completely to help the story, to completely complete the story in the picture. And, you know, I remember seeing that movie over and over and feeling not only is the acting and the imagery important, but you close your eyes, the music takes you there, even if you don't have to see it. Yeah. And that's what they do with this music. It takes you to this world, and it's glamorous, but it's also dark.
It's sad. It's melancholy and beautiful. Yeah. And it's just, I was expecting with glam rock, you know, I have a friend, the Booker, old Booker of the Comedy Store, Adam Egan, who's obsessed with Brian Ferry and Brian Eno and Mott the Hoople and all of these glam, which I don't even know if Mott is glam. Are they glam? Is that
early records? Yes.
Early records. Okay. But it's like, I've just been, I remember him listening to them in the office at the Comedy Store, and I'm like, oh, who is this? And I always expected it to be this big, like, you know, the feather boas, the velvet gold mine that movie. And it's like, this doesn't sound like that. And maybe I'm not seeing the images of what they did live, but I mean, this is Paul McCartney, John Lennon shit, dude. It's fucking incredible.
Yeah. Well, I remember, you know, and thinking about what it must have been like in the studio, and you always imagine curtains and red velvet and candles, and then you see a photo and it's just a white room with no vibe. how do they do it? But it's the people that are doing it. And this is a great story. I was talking to Ozzy, and he said, I told him, you know, a question. I heard you recorded at, you know, the same room the Beatles recorded, Abbey Road. What was it like? And he goes, the Beatles weren't there. It was me and an engineer in a white room. We had to come up with the magic, man. I mean, the stories are there, the Beatles and Floyd and all these bands. But it's what you bring. It's who you are And the room is a room. And I was like, it's so cool. Cause yeah, the whole world is haunted and the whole world is not safe. And then it's also very safe and it's very pure. And it's all about what you do with your time. And I was like, I had to bring up my kid. I was talking about how time is relevant, and what Einstein meant is if you kiss a girl for 10 seconds, it goes by quick. If you take a hot match and put it on your finger for 10 seconds, it goes by very slow. And it's all relevant. What do you do with your time? What do you do with your life? What do you, a terribly boring day goes by so slow, but a very exciting day goes by like a snap. And it's the same amount of time. It's really relevant of like who you are, what you do with that time, and how you, you know, what you leave behind. And what Roxy Music did at Air Studios, I can't imagine going there and feeling a vibe. You have to bring it. And that's what they did. They brought their own vibe and they put it on a, and back then a reel to reel, which is only 15 minutes long and it's virgin tape. You didn't want to record on tape that's already been used. So you got this virgin tape. So it's like that drummer piercing the silence. When they put that the recording down and the red light goes on, what do you do at that moment? And you don't want to say, like today, everyone's going to Pro Tools and you can fix it and it's a digital experience. And a producer is looking at the tracks, not listening. Oh, it doesn't exactly match up. But yeah, but close your eyes. What's it feel like, man? Who cares what it looks like on the computer? And there was no computer then, man. It was like, it was about the feel and capturing the that essence. And like you said, was there boas and lipstick? No, but it sounded like this incredibly glamorous life with a sadness threaded through.
100%. Yeah. I love that you said that about virgin tape there. It's Morty said this a while ago, and I was going to say it earlier is that, you know, you could look at your record collection, even your tape collection, even your CD collection, and you could be proud of it, but you can't be proud of your iTunes collection, you know, your Spotify playlist. And I agree with that. It's like, there's nothing to show off, but there's something beautiful about the old school. God, I'm an old man. Fuck.
Sounds like we're burning both ends. Yeah. Is that a segue?
Good work.
All right, so I'm going to skip over It Could Happen to Me. I do want to talk about Both Ends Burning. So this is the second single. Brian said, we were on a punishing world tour schedule in 75, and there were a lot of late nights to get the Siren album finished on time. I guess this was the inspiration behind that song. And once again, the outro is fire. JT, play the outro.
Yeah, fever, baby. Real fever in it.
Fever. God. I love this song.
And you know what's cool about that drum part? I always like to take a drum beat that's on a drum set and put it in my lap with a djembe or a bongo and really examine the rhythm, not the cymbal or the bass drum or the hat or what drums he's using, but and it all comes down to African. And even the Ringo Starr and Charlie Watt and Ginger Baker, you put it in a djembe and you can feel the African pulse. And I always thought about the environment and where music comes from, like I was saying about the roots of music and the roots of musicians and what they listen to. And if you think about these great African rhythms and then watch an elephant walk, it's where African rhythms come from. And if you go to New York and see the lights in the streets full of people and listen to the drum beats that come out of there. And if you go anywhere and you can look around and see the environment and put it into the drum beats that come from there. And I love listening to British rock because in the 50s, rock and roll from America was a good time. And it was rocking around the clock and it was splishing, splashing in the bath.
Yeah.
Because it was Maybelline. And then, you know, post WW2, England was still in rubble. It was a wreck. And that's why the music sounds like that. They had cities that were destroyed. So you hear Black Sabbath, you hear Cream. And it really wasn't until Vietnam when our people never came back. They came back in a silver box. And then you got the Doors and you got Jefferson Airplane and Grateful Dead singing about the pain.
Yeah.
And then the rock and roll changed because we had something to sing about. And England had that immediately right after WW2. They were inspired by blues and early rock and roll from America, but the way they gave it back still had so much more pain. That's a good thing about COVID in a sense. What happens after COVID is great novels and film and music and poetry because of the pain that we're going through.
Yes. I can't agree with you more about the sound that came out of England and still continues to come out. And you said something earlier, so I forgot to bring it up then, about what's appreciated in America and how something can be popular in England and not be popular here. I remember going to England in like 2006. I was there for about 3 weeks, and I remember the Raconteurs had just dropped their record, their first record, and right. It was the biggest thing in the Virgin record store, whatever the record store was in downtown London. It was like, I mean, in America, they would never have promoted that record the way they were promoting in England, because they appreciate different music because of the weather, because of their feudal system, because of everything that they experience. Just like here in America, where we're a capitalistic community, you know, hip hop is so big right now because that is what is kind of like the sense of the world, or has been while we were rocking before COVID. So I couldn't agree with that more. And you put it perfectly.
But Roxy Music, where they grew up, those band members, where they went to school, and you hear so much about art school and more of a, there was this compression of art and education that America doesn't embrace as much. And you can hear that intelligence in their music, but you also hear the pain of WW2 leaving their city a wreck, or the pain of the 70s when the Pistols happened and Clash, because the Queen didn't care, and there was trash and rubble and rubbish piled up on each corner, and there was, you know, strikes, but they didn't do anything to fix it. And people were like, well, we're going to just become anarchists because we can't take this anymore. Let's put it in the music, man. You know?
For sure. For sure. Morty, is there anything you want to add?
Both Ends Burning. I mean, this and Love Is a Drug was on every set Brian and the band pretty much has ever played after.
Deserves to be. That outro, I would kick my grandma in the titty to see that perform live. Is that what you're thinking to say?
Yeah. If you see Brian Ferry do a solo tour, he's going to put that in his set probably 99% of the time.
Dude, I'm praying that they're going to go on tour because post COVID, everybody wants to get out of their house. You know, I bet you Oasis gets back together, because that's what I'm saying. I bet they get the fuck back together. All right. I want to skip over Nightingale. Let's just do the closer. Just Another High. The first thing I noticed is the intro to me sounded a little bit like Layla. JT, play the intro.
Mm.
You can hear it. It's very, very, very small, but it's there. It's apt. You got it, JT? Or I can do it. Here. All right, we were both playing it at the same time, dude. Here, let's do it again. I'll play it. It's right here. Did you hear what I'm talking about?
The coda of Layla, the piano outro.
Yes.
Jim Gordon, the drummer, wrote that, and Jim is now in jail for chopping his mama.
Is he really?
Jim Gordon also might have ripped it off of Rita Coolidge, because that's the other thing they're saying. He killed his mom with a hammer.
Oh my God. Yeah, one of the great drummers. He was in Traffic and Steely Dan and many, many great acts.
All Things Must Pass, one of our records.
Oh, wow. Right.
Yeah.
But he had a little...
you know what? His grandma was one of those things, huh?
the trouble with Nigel, he had troubles, but one great music. But I do hear that, and it's a great way to end a record. I love falling asleep to that last song, and especially back in the day when you have a record player, and you know it would it would, the last song would kind of drift you off into bed and the needle would come off and go back into its handle. And you wake up and you're like, oh man, I went to sleep to that side B. And that last song really took me there. You know?
Oh, dude, I love that you said side B, because I, in my opinion, besides Love is the Drug, side B crushes it compared to side A, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And then also, what a cool way you start the record about love being addictive, and it makes sense to almost end it with regret and shame of realizing that it's all about chasing another high. I mean, it's really fucking brilliant. And it's just, yeah. I mean, Brian's in familiar melancholy post-breakup mode again on this. And like you said, it is a perfect way to end the record. And then, of course, once again, fire outro. JT, play it. I love it. Kill it for time, but we could listen to this. We should just do a whole nother episode where the four of us just listen to the record.
And you know what's strange? That Brian Eno wasn't there, and you can hear the Eno-isms.
Yeah.
You know, and even the Bowie-isms, and like you said, some of that glamorous, you know, Rocky Horror-isms. I love isms, and you know, a few isms are very important to have.
For
and
sure.
These are good isms, but there's that sense of experiment and experience together. And, you know, I always wondered what they would be like at a big festival, because I love the big festival because it's competitive between the musicians. When the Foo Fighters are playing and the Deftones are next, and then, you know, White Stripes are next, they're all putting on a better show. The audience gets a better show because it's this competitive spirit between bands. And you got 4 days of bands. Not everybody's there to see your band. They're there to see the other band on Sunday. You're playing Saturday. So what are you going to do with your time on stage? Hopefully you can grab them by the heart and by the balls. And I would love to see Roxy Music at a festival and see what they do by destroying the other band members on the other stages, you know?
Yeah, dude, I got to ask you this. Did Jane's Addiction ever have like that one band you're like, dude, we got to blow them off stage? You have like, it was like a nice playful competition. Like, did you have that?
I tell you, it's always that playful competition's always in me, no matter what. And
yeah,
even if other band members are not playing that night, but I know they're in the audience. And there's a great feeling when you look at your guest list and you're like, oh my God, look who's here tonight. Oh, this is, I'm gonna do something special tonight. Yeah. And even though, you know, it's just as special as if they weren't there. But Porno for Pyros went on a tour. It was called The Big Day Out. But we called it The Big Day Off because it's like 2 days a week and then you just hang out in Australia.
Oh,
but
God.
What a tour. Prodigy, Rage, Elastica, Porno, a band called TISM, which stood for This Is The Shit, Man. And and that every night was one of those competitive things because, you know, Rage and Prodigy was just destroying people. And Porno was just kind of like surf band, you know?
Yeah.
Dudes about surfing and loving. So our job was to really kind of tear it up in our own way and not let the Prodigy and the Rage set, you know, destroy everybody to the point where they weren't ready to kind of surf the night away with us. But yeah, it's a great feeling to compete with each other. And that's also what happened in drumming for me. When I went for those from the pillow to the snare drum to the drum set, all these different levels, then I joined the marching band. And I thought I was a great drummer and I was surrounded by 10 drummers that did the same exact thing I did. I realized I wasn't so great. I had to step on the gas if I want to be first chair. And that competitive spirit still sticks with me, not to be better, but to be the best you can. And I compete with myself. And yeah. I'm explaining this to somebody, you know, a social media kills people because they're looking for the thumbs up and the heart and the likes. And I go, man, you don't want people to like you if you're making art. You want to piss people off, man. You know, you can't be liked by everybody. And I remember reading a review saying I was a great drummer and I believed it. And then I read a review that said I stunk. And I'm like, well, if I believe the one that says I'm great, I got one that says I stink. So I just believe in myself. I don't believe it, man. I just don't believe it. And I don't engage when I get on socials. I just like to present positive, motivational drum parts and stories and pictures But if I engage, I start to go down this should I believe it attitude. And I don't believe it, man. I don't count the likes or count the thumbs up or count the hearts. I just put the shit out there and put something else out there a couple hours later, you know?
I fucking can't agree with you anymore. You said some really brilliant shit this episode, but dude, that is like nail on the fucking head, man. By the way, Porto for Pyros can follow Rage and Prodigy. You just got to open with Tahitian Moon. You open with Tahitian Moon. You guys, that song slaps hard, dude. I'm going to listen to that the second I get in the car. All right, Morty. So here, Pete, hold on. Wait. No. We're just going to jump into the facts because I got to, and we're going to, can you do me a favor? So yeah. Peter, edit this part out, me talking to Morty, of course.
Yeah.
Morty, just pick three that you think are the best, and we'll dive into them and we'll do quick facts and then we're out. All right, Morty, hit us with some facts, brother.
So the album cover features a then unknown Texas model named Jerry Hall, who's made up as this, you know, mythical siren. And after meeting Brian on the shoot, she quickly becomes his girlfriend for a few years. And then she's in a few of his music videos. And although they were engaged, she cheated with Mick Jagger, who she eventually very publicly left Brian for in 1977.
That's okay.
Yeah.
That's okay. It's Mick Jagger. If I'm Brian, you got 5 minutes to be mad, and then you see the catalog of Rolling Stones, and you go, okay, yeah, I get it.
Broken. Yeah, imagine having your heart broken after you made a record about having your heart broken by the person on the cover.
Oh, my God, I didn't even fucking think of that, dude.
You know, it's like, I can't even listen to this album that wasn't even about you because you're on the cover.
Holy shit, dude. That is, dude, clip
it's
that shit
Mobius
out.
Be a stripper.
Oh, yeah, my dude. God.
I spent a great afternoon with Mick Jagger. It was a day of music, and he had a huge band, and I think a keyboard, organ, a rhythm guitar, electric guitar, horn section, bass, me on drums, and Mick. And I totally ignored every other musician and just played to Mick. I want to know what Mick, and I just was staring at his ass, making sure it moved all night. And that was my job, you know, make sure Mick was bouncing to my beat.
And oh, I see that right butt cheek moving.
Those moments, man, I played with Lou Reed and Ozzy and Mick and greats that you listen to when you're growing up, and then you're in a room playing with them. And you're never equal, but your job is to embrace the moment and not think about what they did, but think about what's happening in the moment. And it's really hard when you're surrounded by these great musicians, these great names, these legacies. But the most important thing is just to play in the moment and be present. It's like a tennis game. If you got to rally, you got to volley each other. You know, you can't be looking at the guy and get aced every time. You got to play. And that was a great lesson, playing with Mick and learning the importance of living in the moment, being in the moment, not tripping on the past or what's going to feel like tomorrow when I'm talking about it like now. But what it was like in the moment. And that's just it's a great feeling. So I guess Jerry got a little of that too, Jerry Hall, a little in the moment.
Dude, you saw those butt cheeks move for sure, dude.
That satisfaction for sure. Yo.
All right, hit us with another one.
All right. Let's see, which one is a good one? Oh, this is a great one. Okay. In an interview with Playgirl magazine that summer, Ferry was asked, how does it feel to know that women look at your picture and masturbate? And he coolly answered, actually, I'm very flattered. I just thought that's just
didn't
a great
know?
Like, what do you say to that? Bitchin'. You know, like.
Wait, JT, can you pull up a picture of Brian Ferry? I want to see if this guy is, you know, flick the bean worthy. Is that, can I say that in 2021? Because I did.
He's adorable.
Is he sexy?
He's
guys.
Yes.
It's like asking three guys. Is Brian Ferry sexy?
Come on. Look at that dude. He's James.
Dude, he looks like George. Dude, he looks like George Lazenby from James Bond. Yeah. And 90210. George Lazenby was in
Secret Service.
You got a younger picture of him?
Right there, dude. Look at him right there on the right.
Mm-hmm.
That's young.
No, he's younger than everyone.
I mean,
young.
Come on, dude. He looks like my assistant principal.
Who pulled Jerry Hall.
I mean, yeah, but, you know, we all saw how that ended.
Yeah. He was a good, I mean, he was a good looking Pope.
He's a great looking guy. I listen, police army, if you know him, Brian, I'm sorry. Listen, you are gorgeous.
Listen,
and you are. Yeah, there it is right there, dude.
Yeah.
Right there with the cigarette.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. He brought Duran Duran. You see Duran Duran in him. You see where all of that came from.
Good point. You know,
yeah, it's all, you know, it's all
when I meet some great drummer, I've met a few that just take me to another level. I always tell them they're the master, I'm the Bates.
You do see
that Duran Duran confidence and that the style and the sense of like, come look at me and enjoy it while you do it.
Dude, you, Steve, Stephen, if you get a chance, man, and this is all the Fleece Army listening, dude, re-listen to that. If you haven't listened to the John Taylor Roxy Music for Your Pleasure episode, dude, that guy, it was just, it's so great. You know what I've noticed? And I think everybody, except for you, Stephen, because this is your first jam with us, anybody we've had on for either Brian Eno or Roxy Music has been so fun and connected, but also intelligent about being able to describe the album and describe the feelings with it and the technical shit of what they're doing. So maybe this is like Roxy Music is like the men's of music, right?
You gotta have an IQ to understand it, man. You got
100%. All right, Morty, you got one more?
Yeah, last one we got is in the film clip for Love is the Drug, which became the music video you see all the time. Both the backup singers are dressed in these form-fitting vintage women's Royal Air Force uniforms. And Ferry is in a military outfit as well. And he's wearing an eye patch. And most people assume that he's like in some weird quirky fashion thing. But actually, it was covering a bandage because he had earlier walked into a door. So all of a sudden, now that's his shtick. And he's got a, everyone's like, now I'm wearing an eye patch to go see them play.
Exactly.
You know, we're that's all pirate chic now.
Yeah. I love it. Do you have any injuries, Steven? Anything that happened to you while on stage you had to play through?
Yeah, I mean, my heart's been broken many times on stage. You know, I remember Perry had, we were doing a Caught Stealing, and you know, Perry's like, I stole my hat. Hey, Navarro, what'd you steal? Dave, your girlfriend. Oh. And I started scratching my head. Is he talking to me? And then, you know, they asked me what I stole. I stole the show.
Best answer.
See,
best
that's one,
fucking
that's
answer.
One of us. That's the schmaltz coming through.
There it is, dude.
That's the Borschtfeld coming through.
All right. Let's do some rapid questions and then we'll get you out of here, buddy. Okay. Sure. All right. Favorite song on the record, Steven?
Well, that's hard to say, man, because I guess Love is the Drug is the tune I've heard the most.
Yeah.
And I hear it more often than any other. So I guess that's the one that really pulls my heart because it makes me feel like I'm back then listening to the record for the first time. And then my band Halloween Jack with Gilby, we covered it. So, you know, I guess it's kind of like the default, but at the same time, that's the one that always makes me feel like and it's the first track on the record. So it feels like every time I hear it, I'm about to go listen to the brand new record again. Yeah. So let's go with that, you know?
Okay.
And I love, like I said, those timbali feels and the drum ideas.
For sure.
In that sense. So yeah, let's go.
For sure. All right. This is a trickier one. Least favorite song of the record or the song that you skip over the most?
She Sells.
Perfect. All right. Now this is an even trickier one. What song on this record would you fuck to?
Which one wouldn't I?
Ah, your whole record. You're starting with Love is a Drug and then just another.
There was a time lasting 30 to 40 seconds was my goal. Now it's a 30 to 40 minute goal.
Ah, you're turning into Sting, dude. I like that. Okay.
You don't want to ask Navarro about this one again.
Yeah. All right, last question. Does this deserve to be on the 500 greatest albums list? And is it ranked accordingly? What's the ranking, JT?
374.
Oh,
glad you're confident about that.
Well, that's the appropriate number. Absolutely. Well, of course. Yeah.
Sure.
And you know what? it does. And then there's a reason when you think about critics and if they wrote a piece and if they rank something, where did they get this and how did they feel that day? And would they be different 5 years later or 5 years prior? Would they rank it somewhere else? But it is this great 38, 42 minute piece of art. And absolutely. And, you know, you got to say Dark Side of the Moon and Sgt. Pepper's and, you know, Zeppelin 4, or whatever they are, the top five that are always there. Absolutely. But they're interchangeable. And I think it belongs at $4.99 or number one, depending how you feel that day.
Yeah, no, I couldn't agree with you more. I mean, I definitely believe that this deserves to be on the list more than For Your Pleasure. Not saying For Your Pleasure doesn't deserve to be on it. I'm just saying it. This one is, this is a banger. Steven, I can't thank you enough for coming on, buddy. Anything you want to promote, please do.
Love and happiness, baby. That's it.
I love that. Morty.
Halloween Jack.
Halloween Jack.
Yeah, got it.
No, I got it. I've got a band. It's called Jane's Addiction.
Oh,
I might have heard of them.
We should bring them up.
We're gonna do something. I think that it's time to get back to work. When they lift the North America, that's one way. And when they lift it all over the world, let's go global. I love playing with those guys. When Perry says 3, 4, nothing feels better than that for me. But I have a band also with Nikolai from the Strokes. That's called Summer Moon. He's the bass player. That's a great experiment. It's us playing music and trying to capture this cinematic Roxy Music type of feeling. It's a really cool band. And then I've got Think EXP, which is like a Pink Floyd immersive band. We call it Think Floyd. And that's got the saxophone player from Pink Floyd. His name's Scott Page. So, you know, I like to stay busy. Then with Mike Watt, I got a punk rock band called Hellride.
Yeah.
And Mike Watt.
Mike Watt, dude, he's our guru. We've had him on the podcast. I think I got 3 words in the whole podcast. But that motherfucker, I love him more than life itself.
Yeah, he can talk and he's got great stories. And you ask him about, you know, Flag and Circle Jerks and the Germs, and he just lights up. He loves talking about punk rock.
Yeah. Right back to D-Boom. You know,
He's a great guy. D Boone, his birthday was April 1st.
Yep.
And when I first met Mike Watt, 1986, Jane's played with Firehose. This guy gets off the stage and gives me a bear hug. And he's like, I'm Watt. Who are you? I said, I'm Perk. He's like, all right, Perk. And we've been friends ever since, man.
I love it. Awesome. That really warms my heart. Morty, you got any shout outs?
Yeah, for this, I'm going to give a shout out to one of our listeners, MC Small Fries, who's always so great to us, one of the Fleece Army. Go to B and Daddy Cartoons on Instagram. Follow me, DJ Morty Coyle on Twitter and on Clubhouse, and Fokker Force 5 on Facebook. I'm singing Love is a Drug tomorrow night, and I'm going to throw in a Jane song tomorrow night.
Nice. Just for that. Yeah, check out Morty. I mean this to everybody listening, man. Check out Morty. If you can ever see him live at Canner's, or if you can watch it online right now, it's incredible. That's how we met. And you're great, dude. Thank you, man. You know, you're a fucking lunatic, but you're great.
Absolutely.
JT, what do you got?
At JT_podcast exec to tweet, Instagram post, whatever. And then at NC Podcasts is the company, Next Chapter Podcast. We produce this show. And we're starting with Shakespeare this Friday. We have Macbeth episode one this Friday.
You know, I'm excited about that, dude. Yeah, you know, I am so excited. Steven, this has been great, man. I mean this. Love and happiness to you, brother. I can't thank you enough for taking time out to talk, bud.
You got it. Let's go look at the Nine Inch Nails.
Yeah.
Age. James, that's what I like to do. Oh, here's me in the 90s.
Oh, what? Shit. What's up, Brian Ferry? Good God. I'm gonna go to the bathroom and have a little skidoodle scoodle. You know what I'm talking about.
Thanks for having me, fellas. This has been a lot of fun.
My pleasure, buddy.
I can't wait to be in person and have a beer and coffee or a coffee.
Yes. Oh, dude, I'm taking you up on coming to see you because I still talk to Perry. And I'm definitely coming. If you guys do a show in LA or if we're in the same city, if I'm on tour, I'm 100% coming. And I'll keep up with you on social and everything. It's just, you're great, dude.